for centuries, we tried to figure out what this thing called language does and how it relates to human thought. Plato tried to analyze our language to arrive at essential concepts that would refer to the immanent reality of pure forms, while many medieval thinkers supposed that the grammar of language opens the human intellect to some metaphysical truth. Realizing that ordinary language does not adequately reflect human thought, Leibniz wanted to construct a systematically rigid calculus of thought, as he called the project, and many thinkers like Gottlob Frege and Bertrand Russell followed this idea. With the construction of the so-called ideal language, they tried to analyze the underlying logical structure of our thought through language. However, the philosophies of the late Ludwig Wittgenstein and Paul Grice showed that the relation between thought and language is deeply hidden in the way that we use language, since it's predominantly determined with situational contexts and conventions surrounding language. This is where psycholinguistics, or simply the psychology of language, emerged as an independent study of the interrelation between linguistic factors and psychological aspects. It concerns itself with psychological and neurobiological factors that enable humans to acquire, use, comprehend, and produce language. So it's about the mechanisms in which languages are processed and represented in the mind and brain. One of the questions that psycholinguists try to answer is how we learn language. Historically, perhaps the most well-known account of the acquisition of language can be found in the writings of Saint Augustine. When grown-ups named some object and at the same time turned towards it, I perceived this and I grasped that the thing was signified by the sound they uttered, since they meant to point it out. In this way, little by little, I learned to understand what things the words which I heard uttered in the respective places in various sentences signified, and once I got my tongue around these signs, I used them to express my wishes. Although fairly intuitive, this idea was seriously challenged by a thought experiment expressed in a popular anecdote about the first European colonizers in Australia pointing at an animal that they have never seen before and the Australian natives replying with kangaroo, which supposedly means I don't know, but the colonizers took it to be the name of the animal. This anecdote, however, was completely made up to prove a point, but the original thought experiment was presented by Willard von Orman Quine, who wants us to imagine a linguist discover a new tribe with a previously unheard of language. He tries to carefully observe the tribesmen use the language, and as a rabbit jumps from the bushes, they cry out Gavagai. It's tempting to guess that the word simply refers to the rabbit. But as the linguist soon finds out, it could mean anything. Animal, fur, dinner, mine, cute, small, look, forest god. No matter how long the linguist observes the tribesmen use their language, every translation that he will construct will simply be an hypothesis, open to revision. This situation is analogous to a child trying to learn the language of his parents. The process will be long and messy and often unreliable. This idea paved the way to a serious skeptical attack on the assumption that we can ever know that the meanings we ascribe to the words we use don't radically differ from the meanings other people ascribe to them. This sort of skeptical challenge is often referred to as Wittgenstein's paradox. This is a serious challenge to the view that language must be learned, which was especially popular before 1960 and was represented by Jean Piaget, the empiricist Rudolf Carnap, and the behaviorism school, which put forth the view that language is a behavior shaped by conditioned response. After 1960, an important breaking point emerged when Noam Chomsky, highly critical of behaviorist and mentalist theories of language, posited that humans possess a special, innate ability for language and that complex syntactic features such as recursion are hardwired in the brain. In this view, it's highly probable that we can learn the language of our parents properly and without any serious discrepancy in the meanings that we associate to the words we use, since our so-called language instincts brings our attention to the same features of the world that our parents found relevant enough to name them. It's worth mentioning that the field of linguistics and psycholinguistics nowadays has been defined by reactions to Chomsky, pro and contra. It's an interesting and exciting field of inquiry, promising to unveil a great mystery: how words map our mental associations to the world and how we can communicate those ideas to people around us. It's an important question because in order to investigate the world, we have to communicate. Both science and humanities grow to be collaborative efforts. This was a very short introduction to psycholinguistics by Bebe Flapula. I kindly invite you to check out my videos on the philosophy of language, where I present the historical discussion around these same topics. And thank you for your attention. I really hope this was informative.